一下。 大家好，歡迎嚟到我哋呢個文房雅趣嘅瓷器篇，我係今日嘅主講人馮禮傑。咁再一次咧，非常感謝官樂怡博士一直以嚟對我哋嘅支持啦，同埋有官樂怡基金會咁好嘅平台，亦都感謝今日咁多位對中國文化感興趣嘅朋友過嚟啦。
Good evening, everyone. So welcome to this lecture called Literati Elegance number 3. So I'm today's speaker, Calvin Fong, and thank you again. Thank you, Dr. Hui Cunha, as well as Fundação Hui Cunha as a platform for us. So I really happy to see all of you here tonight who are very interested in the traditional Chinese culture. So this is the third edition of the series. So today we'll talk about porcelain and also we'll focus on the concept of the study. So thank you for your support. I'd like to talk more about the scholar's studio or the concept so-called the study as well. So this is actually a concept that's been evolving and now it's a very mature concept now.
所以呢,我哋讲返文房嘅起源,所以你觉得,点解会有文房呢样嘢呢?呢个文房嘅概念又系
So why do we have this concept so-called Wen Fang or Scholar's Studio and when this concept started? So the concept of scholar studio started when with the need of us to express and record. So in the past, when we had war and we have to record everything. For example, even when some important decrees, when they are introduced by the government, these has to be recorded. However, before before Han Dynasty, people used bamboo slips to record all these informations. However, they are very heavy. That's why eventually when things are recorded, they are usually major events in history. So until the West Han Dynasty, Cai Lun has invented the papermaking technology. So that it's when the concept of scholar studio started.
咁樣有造紙術之後呢,個載體的解放呢,就好似我哋嘅思想嘅解放咁樣,佢物質豐富啦,先可以方便我哋將我哋思想表達出嚟嘛。
So the liberation of the vehicle or the carrier is actually the liberation, symbolizes the liberation of thought. So that it's the moment when our spiritual well-being was enriched. So that it's when people started painting and expressing themselves.
所以呢佢有呢個紙同筆嘅普及之後呢，咁我哋又需要一個空間去將我嘅諗法表達出嚟，咁無論有室外㗎嘛，咁太陽又曬又熱，啊又有雨水又有汗水，咁又會淋濕嗰啲紙㗎嘛，同埋啲墨呢都好易乾啊，咁所以呢，呢個室內嘅環境呢係有助於我哋整理我哋嘅思緒啊，我哋需要一個安靜嘅思考空間。
所以就有咗書房嘅出現啦。咁呢個都係我哋嘅第一個主題啊。所以文房首先係我哋思想嘅一個延伸。So after the invention of brushes and paper, we need a space to express ourselves, right? So we can't do it outdoor because the sunlight and the ink will be dried. So all of these obstacles actually contributed to the invention of studios, scholar studios. So that is the space for us to be quiet and calm down and organize our thoughts. So we call it the extension of thoughts. Scholar studio is the extension of our thinking.
所以呢，書房就係我哋窺視、窺見呢個文人觀念嘅一個天地，佢係屬於我哋好個人嘅一個精神空間。咁所以呢。 有咗呢個大環境嘅改善之後咧，咁第一個推動文房發展嘅決定性因素嘅出現咧，佢就係我哋隋代開始嘅一個科舉制度啊。睇一張古畫，呢個係古時候嘅科舉嘅場景。咁科舉制度咧，佢促進咗呢個隋唐文人階層嘅產生啊。所以咧，佢筆墨啊、紙砚啊，佢除咗呢啲之外咧，佢 不可分離嘅一啲文房容器開始出現啦，就好似除咗筆墨紙砚之外，仲有筆筒啊、墨床啊、水柱啊、香爐啊、案屏啊咁呢啲精美嘅文房用具。咁喺古代人眼裏裏面咧，佢呢個唔單止係佢一個實用嘅工具，佢更加係佢哋平時精神嘅一個良伴，即係一個伴侶。
Scholar's studio is actually allows us to take a glimpse at the world of traditional scholars in China, and it's also a very personal and spiritual space for them. So one of the decisive critical factors of promoting the existence of scholar's studios is the so-called imperial examination system that was popularized, that was very important back in Sui dynasty. So after that actually allows a group of scholars class to exist. And we see in the studio, we see different tools like brushes, ink, and paper. All of these, they are not only tools, but also a spiritual companion for these scholars in everyday life.
我哋先簡單介紹下瓷器到底係乜嘢咁。其實瓷器咧，簡單嚟講係土同火結合嘅一個藝術。佢其實同時都係人為製造嘅物品。咁歷代嘅陶瓷裝飾咧，佢既有自然界嘅山水啊、花鳥魚龍啊，佢又有人類自己嘅一種文飾。佢表達咗人嘅一個自然觀念，佢人嘅想像啊，人嘅理想嘅情緒啊。
So as we can see from the slides, ceramics or porcelains, they are actually an art of combining soul and fire. It reflects our mind, subjective consciousness of human, as well as expresses the concept of nature, imagination, emotions, and ideals.
咁睇翻我哋嘅呢個瓷器特性，其實佢瓷器咧，佢最大嘅優點咧就在於佢可塑性好強啊！佢可以製造各種形狀嘅器物啦，佢滿足人哋嘅需求，同埋可以喺光素嘅一個瓷胎上面咧，用竹去刻嗰啲花紋啊。 去繪畫啊，去做一啲詞雕啊，所以佢就有好高嘅一個藝術性。佢一出嚟咧，就受到人哋嘅喜愛咯。
So the characteristics of porcelain is that it's highly plastic, it's highly malleable, so people can actually easily carve different patterns or make drawings on it. So it's highly artistic. So once it's invented, people love it so much.
咁嗱，我哋睇翻咧佢瓷器最呢個工藝流程圖。 其實瓷器咧，佢最基礎嘅組成部分分係兩部分嘅，一部分係佢嘅瓷胎，一部分係佢嘅釉。咁其實胎咧，佢可以細分為呢個磁石啊、高嶺土啊、呢個莫奈石啊，佢嗰啲混合配比咧，佢燒製而成。佢每個時代咧，佢都有少少唔同嘅，因為你畫個山體咧，你畫到呢度。 OK， 佢係呢個配比，然之後畫到下面佢唔同咁。咁咧，另一部分就係釉面喎，釉面都係大學問嘅。咁但係今日時間咧，關係好簡單介紹一下啦。呢個釉咧，佢分為呢個釉上彩同埋釉下彩嘅。我哋常見嗰種青花瓷咧，就係釉下彩，佢表面係有一種玻璃光澤嗰種釉面啊，因為佢青花圖案咧喺上釉之前咧。 畫落去嘅，然之後再燒嘅，所以咧依種就叫釉下彩啦。然之後釉上彩咧就係燒好嘅一個素坯上面去畫嘅一個彩繪，佢再即係要燒咗一次先，然之後再經過800度左右嘅中低温，二次燒成嘅，好似粉彩啊、五彩都屬於呢個釉上彩咯。
So let me talk, introduce to you the basic concepts of porcelain. So it's divided in two parts, the porcelain body and the glaze. So today we don't have much time to talk about everything in detail. And as we can see now, glaze is divided in, there are two types of glazing. One is overglazed, the other one's underglazed. So the blue and the very popular blue and white glaze on porcelain that we see belongs to the underglaze. So usually after painting and putting the glaze and then the porcelain body is put, the clay body is put to burn and fired. So that's why we have the very beautiful surface. So then another type, it's called overglaze. So after the clay body is fired, we only until then the glaze is applied onto the surface. Mm.
咁咧，瓷器嘅燒製温度咧都係瓷器同陶器最大嘅分別啊！佢只有胎體咧係達到1200度到1300度左右嘅高温培燒，佢先有嗰個物理性能啦。所以咧喺科學技術唔發達嘅古代嚟講咧，燒製瓷器係一個非常複雜嘅工藝，所以佢分工都好明確嘅。
So the biggest difference between a pottery and a porcelain is actually the firing temperature. So only when the temperature reaches as high as 1,200 to 1,300 degrees Celsius, can we call this a porcelain? And so in the past, in the ancient times, it's a very complicated technology. So not many civilizations achieved this technology as well.
嗯，咁根據呢個明代科學家宋應星嗰個《天工開物》嗰本書記載咧，佢共計1批之力過手72方可成器，即係話咧佢要經過72個人嘅手咧，佢每個人係唔同嘅工序，即係練泥嘅就練泥，拉坯嘅就拉坯。 因為佢手繪嗰個瓷畫咧，佢需要一筆一畫咁樣去將個瓷圖案咧係畫喺個瓷器上面，跟住屬於人工創作。佢仲要經過上釉啦，所以佢週期咧生產週期好長，佢成本好高，同埋佢個損壞嘅機率都唔細。
In a book called Tian Gong Kai Wu, in the Ming Dynasty, it writes a clay or a porcelain must pass through 72 pairs of hands
before it's achieved and completed. So it means actually the whole procedure has actually gone through 72 steps. So everyone has their own job. So each of all the patterns or paintings on the porcelain is were handmade. So it actually it's a very long production cycle, and it's very costly, and it's easy to break as well.
大家可以睇下呢張誒瓷器個發展圖啊，佢由右到左咧係個時間嘅發展，由公元前5000年到依個1900年，咁依個向下咧就係依個瓷器嘅嗰個時間，依個向下就瓷器嘅發展，咁由陶器咧一直去到元始清池啊，一直去到依個景德鎮白瓷有下彩，佢發展係一直係咁樣向前發展嘅，咁依個就係佢黑色咧就係佢發明嘅時間啦。 譬如呢個青花咧係由1300年左右元朝開始發明，咁其實呢個1300年開始咁，佢呢個就好詳細咁可以了解到我哋中國嘅瓷器個發展咯。
As you can see from this screen, we see a map of the development of porcelain in China. So on the very top, you see time in the chronological order from right to the left side. From the 5000 BCE to now 1900. So from the vertical index, you can see the different types of porcelains were being made. For example, like painted pottery and then the greenware and all that. So for example, the blue and white porcelain was actually invented in 1300 during the Ming and Yuan and Ming dynasty. So this is a very detailed overview of the development of porcelain in China.
咁發展去到呢個宋朝啦，我哋係我哋嘅中國瓷器一個高峰嚟嘅，甚至我哋中國美學嘅一個高峰。咁佢古代文人佢哋嘅審美咧，我哋可以由呢個古畫可以窺探一二。
So as you can see, the Song dynasty was actually the pinnacle of the development of porcelain as well as the pinnacle of aesthetics in China.
咁唐宋八大家入邊咧，歐陽修、蘇洵、蘇適、蘇澈、王安石、曾巩，佢六位都係宋朝嘅。然之後咧，佢個政治家啊，個個都係大詩人、大詞人，佢甚至係一個畫家、美學家。咁喺咁樣嘅一個文化環境氛圍入邊咧，佢宋代咧。 佢就演化咗一種柔同埋雅嘅一種氛圍啦，所以宋代咧都俾西方嘅學者稱為東方嘅文化文藝復興。As
we know, the so-called the eight masters of the Song and Tang dynasty, so six of them actually lived during the Song dynasty. So all of them were very famous poets and literary figures. So people called in the West, people call Song Dynasty was actually the Eastern Renaissance. And so, and also the Song Dynasty has created this atmosphere of elegance and gentleness. And that was lauded overall by the world.
所以古代古人呢，佢講究失無恥不雅，就係尤其是咧文人嘅文房陳設咧，佢更加係追求呢個。 造型嘅精緻啊，同埋佢內涵啊，所以瓷器咧係百姓嘅日用品，係王公貴族嘅奢侈品。佢仲曾經咧係一個中國最主要嘅貿易出口對象啊。佢一直一度咧係俾歐洲嘅貴族咧係追捧嘅。嗰陣時咧係擁有一件中國瓷器係佢哋富有同埋高貴嘅象徵啊。
So the ancient people say that a room is not elegant without porcelain, so especially for the scholars' studios. So the any decor of any rooms are actually decorated by porcelains. So porcelain, it's not only the everyday containers or objects by common people, but also a luxury of the aristocrats. So it was actually one of the major export products of China. So it was very widely sought after by the European aristocracy. So this is actually a symbol of wealth and elegance.
咁嚟到我哋呢個藏品介紹啦。 我哋中國式嘅寫書法啊，畫山水畫啊，可以都係用水嚟做媒介啊，為一個圍繞做中心嘅。我哋書寫嘅每一步都離唔開水嘅，即係首先咧，我哋將個水加入個墨砚嗰度，然之後咧磨成墨汁，再用嗰個毛筆點墨啊，寫完之後咧，再用清水玩筆。 所以咧，我哋用水咧就必須要有水器啦。佢演滴同埋水咧，水柱咧，其實都係向個墨砚加水嘅。佢功能相同啊，但係有嘴咧叫水柱，啊冇嘴嗰啲咧就叫水呈啊。咁水柱係執壺形嘅，佢又叫做柱子啊，叫做柱壺，叫做偏題。喺唐宋兩代咧，佢係作為一個酒壺嚟使用嘅。 大約十三十四厘米左右啊！去到五代至北宋咧，佢嘅器身咧逐漸升高啦。咁所以咧，你可以睇到喺我哋嘅唐宋嘅古畫入邊咧，就經常都有出現嘅呢個水呈同水柱。呢個就係南宋噶啦，呢個執壺水柱，呢個吳蔭清下圖。然之後呢個咧就係。
So in the traditional Chinese art, including calligraphy and Chinese painting, water is the medium, is the key medium. And we use water to put into the ink stone and ink it's produced. And then we use a brush to dip the ink and draw and paint on the papers. At the end, we use water to clean the brushes. So. As you can see, there are various scholars' objects, including inkstones, droppers, and water droppers, as you can see from these two paintings on the slides. Mm. And there are many different types of water droppers or related containers, as you can see.
咁喺古代呢個水柱咧，佢係古代文人必備嘅文房用品嚟嘅。佢有作用咧，就係 喺啲墨砚嗰度啲墨汁乾嗰陣時咧，佢就加幾滴水落去，佢就防止個墨砚乾。但係咧，你要小心咧，唔好多得水一滯咧，沖淡嘅墨汁喎。嗰啲幾滴水啱好啊，所以佢咧就做到呢個器型咧就好小巧好細嘅。So
the water dropper is actually an essential for all the scholars. So they has to be made small in size because if you put too much water into the ink, it will be diluted terribly. So it has to be of the right size to make the perfect ink.
大家可以睇下呢件嚟到現場嘅藏品咧，佢就擺喺嗰張台嗰度，好細細個嘅一個水柱嚇。佢器型好好周正啊，好端莊啊。 但係咧，佢形狀線又好婀娜喎，有西頸啊，有鋒肩啦，有曲柄啊，圓竹啊咁樣。佢係青白釉啊，遍布青白釉，冇紋飾啊。但係佢個油缸咧又保存得好好喎，好有光澤，由宋朝傳到依家嘅差唔多1000年啦。呢個保存得好好一個狀態。
As you can see now on the desk there is this small water dropper. It's a very beautifully craft and shape. You can see the curves, and it has a thin and slim neck, as well as a rich and ample shoulder with a beautiful handle as well. It's called Qingbai glaze. There's no patterns or on the surface. It's very well kept. It has a history of 1,000 years, and it's very well preserved now.
Mm. 咁咧，佢瓜菱形咧，佢唔同於圓形咧。你圓形可以拉坯嗰陣時可以轉，就咁攞樣啦。瓜菱形係唔得嘅。佢瓜菱形個坯體咧係做起嚟咧係難過圓形好多嘅，因為按住嗰個比例啊，同埋佢係有少似南瓜咁啦，好富有變化。佢淨係幾個簡單嘅線條去劃分呢個空間啦。佢呢度咧係呢個尾啊。 喺呢度係做緊減法啊！佢其實越簡單咧，就越突出佢個線條尾啊！咁所以呢個體現咗北宋嗰陣時咧個青白瓷嘅製作高超技巧，同埋嗰陣時嗰啲人嘅審美啊。
As you can see, the shape of this water dropper is it's lobed shape. It's unlike a round shape, which is actually very easy to make. Yet this shape, it looks like a little pumpkin. It's voluptuous in terms of the shape and the contour. So now the concept of beauty is minimalist. It's simple. It gets actually the more beauty in it. So it actually represents and showcases the concept of aesthetics back in Song Dynasty.
So the形象是源自於金銀器，在博物館都可以見到的，好像這個就是現藏於大英博物館，它形象是很相似的，大家可以感受一下這種宋瓷之美，它美在哪裡呢？它的美是跨越時間的，它是跨越種族的，它很素雅。
So as you can see on the slide, that the water droplet that we talk about is similar in the form, like that of similar bottles or water droplets in the British Museum, and we can try to feel the beauty of it. So it's a beauty that defies time and race as well. It's beautiful because of its simplicity and the restrained beauty. And it's very elegant, and it's beautiful.
So, the name of the king
So as we know that there's this famous town called Jingde city in China. So it was originally called Changnan. So actually Jingde was actually the name of the era name of the Emperor Zhenzong of Song Dynasty. So because of this town, it's famous of exporting all these porcelains. So eventually, the emperor named this town Jingde. So eventually, this town became famous.
除了跟住嚟下一件藏物，除咗我哋書寫用嘅水紙之外咧，仲有一件必不可少嘅一個雅物，叫琴爐啦。琴爐我哋可能依家用得少啲嚇，係嘛？咁可以睇下呢個依幅玫瑰宋徽宗趙吉嘅古畫。 啊，聽琴圖嘅一個場景，這個就係佢哋嗰陣時嘅生活一個狀態。佢睇下佢中間咧，佢道觀圓圖，居中坐，形神俯瞰啊。佢嘅環境好高雅，佢依個咧，佢就係佢哋平時嘅一個生活場景啦。咁佢睇一個祭案嗰度，香爐嘅香煙渺渺啊，佢有一個祈石咧去栽種住呢個花瓶啊，同埋同咁。 加埋啲琴聲一齊咧，佢所以嗰個氛圍咧就好清幽嘅，啊咁受到呢個宋徽宗影響咧，佢北宋嗰陣時咧，佢嗰啲人咧都好崇尚風雅嘅，佢就唔不冇呢個奢華嘅，啊咁就偏好自然咯，以簡朴雅致為美咯嚇嗰陣時，咁所以咧佢哋對呢個自由風韻嘅一個追求咧，佢成就咗呢啲宋詞嘅美啊。
So now I'll introduce to you another object called Qinglu, or so-called a small incense burner. So as you can see in this painting, where all these scholars and gentlemen, they play guqin and string instrument, and they enjoy this music, and that's stones and rocks, and they actually enjoy the environment. So all of these is actually a very quiet, tranquil atmosphere. And that is actually the kind of life that these gentlemen and scholars sought after in the Song Dynasty.
琴楼咧喺古代嗰陣時一直都係不可缺少嘅文房用器嚟嘅，因為喺古代宴樂場嗰度咧喺書齋嗰個離唔開佢嗰個琴室啊，嗰啲樂器伴奏啊。咁同時都係位於便於計時咧，即係好似大家聽過一炷香嘅時間咁啊，佢即係彈一首歌哦，彈幾耐一炷香嘅時間咁點咋香咁。咁所以咧，同埋喺彈啊吹樂器嗰陣時咧，佢又中意個點香助興啊。 所以佢就有一個詞語叫做萬把搖琴苦，啊靜雞停香爐，佢係專門呢種嘅一個詩句，所以咧就呢種小型嘅琴爐咧，呢個需求就誕生出嚟。So
back in the days, incense burner was a must for these scholars. So they not only they actually play guqin and different musical instruments in the studio. So the other function of this incense burner is to time, it acts as a timer. So after the incense was burned out, it's actually helping them to keep time. So this is multifunctional, and it's actually an accompaniment for these scholars.
Yeah, okay. You go. 一個宋代，然之後後面呢個都係嗰陣時不可缺少。Yeah,
that's the incense burners in Song Dynasty, and they are very essential for scholars.
咁跟住落嚟咧，就睇下我哋呢個藏品啦，呢個咁小巧可愛嘅一個鈞搖青釉三竹琴爐啦。佢嘅造型好古朴啊，器身又好規整，佢同古畫上面嗰個咧好好似啊，所以佢。 通體都係絲釉嘅，內外絲釉嘅，啊，佢釉質咧，鈞搖釉質就特點咧，就係特別嘅濃厚，好厚潤。佢個釉紋咧，佢自然流淌嘅。佢有時咧，佢有啲鈞搖咧，佢底部仲有啲垂釉添，因為佢係用柴燒嘅過程入邊咧，佢因為用柴燒嘅慢慢升温啊嘛，所以嗰啲釉佢會慢慢融化，佢啲釉係流動嘅，所以你見到有一種流淌嘅感覺。
As now you can see from the slide, this is called the Jin-killed tripod censer from the Northern Song Dynasty. You can see the beauty of it. It's very plain but simplistic, and it looks like a porcelain coming out from a painting. You can see the glazing is very rich but also full. And you can see the glaze actually dripping and flowing in its own way, because it was made by the wooden fire. So it was fired. The temperature when it was fired, the temperature increased gradually. So you can see there's this glaze running on the surface of the porcelain. Mm.
咁佢內外都有絲釉啦，佢有少少開片嘅，咁同埋佢內部咧有啲酒釉，因為佢持長嗰啲手法好快嘅，佢宋代嗰陣時啊，佢咁樣啊，沾乜油咁樣，所以咧佢唔會話成個浸潤佢，佢就係咁樣，所以咧佢嗰陣時係不拘一格嘅。咁呢個佢個節底就有露胎痕啦，啊見到啲呢個嘅同埋咧呢個竹上面咧佢。 是有呢個醬色嘅護胎釉啊，嗱，呢個啡少少嘅，佢就係防止佢燒嗰陣時咧，燒裂啊，呢個保護嘅胎體嘅。咁呢個竹尖咧，佢呢個咧就好似呢個枝釘嘅風格啊，即係尖嘅啊，同埋佢隱隱約約咧可以睇到佢香灰色嗰種嘅胎體啊，所以呢個就係呢個北宋時期咧三竹爐嘅一個經典造型。
This object was actually glazed both inside and the outside. So you can see back then the technique of making it, it's very stylish, and the technicians, they just apply the glaze by a brush or two. So you see it's very beautiful. And you see the bottom of this porcelain, it's we can see the clay body. So that it's a very signature porcelain model.
君窯咧，佢以精湛嘅工藝啦，同埋佢個釉色咧，係成為呢個我哋呢個北宋五大名窯嘅。佢係北宋時期咧，佢個御窯啊，宮廷用瓷嘅重要窯藏嘅。佢依家係就喺個河南縣嘅汝州，喺中間河南嗰只君窯，呢個五大名窯。咁咧，佢宋瓷嗰陣時嘅
So this porcelain was actually produced in Jun kiln during the Song Dynasty, one of the five famous kiln sites in the Song Dynasty. The characteristics of this type of porcelain is actually very delicate. You see the color is very plain. It has a milk-like texture. And especially in this slide, you can see on the surface, there are little bubbles. And so under the light, it actually shows a very delicate quality and surface.
咁呢個爐咧，佢同呢個北京故宮博物院呢個君窯天南三燭爐其實好似嘅，佢就係嗰陣時嗰種嘅經典嘅器型啦，佢都係釉色都好似嘅，青釉係我哋我國使用最早、用得最耐嘅一種釉色，佢其實青咧，古人嗰種青咧，
So as you can see from this screen, that this is actually a Jun tripod sensor now collected and kept in Palace Museum. So it's very much alike to what we are presenting here on the desk. It's a very signature shape. It's in even the glaze color, it's quite similar. So when we talk about Qing, the color Qing is actually it's between blue and green. So every it ranges from blue and green. So all of these colors we call it Qing in Chinese.
咁跟住落嚟，我哋讲第三件藏品。
So now we'll talk about our third collection.
Okay.
Collection.
筆筒都係我哋呢個文房用品咧，不可缺少喎。佢係放筆嘅。咁佢有研究者咧，佢按照呢個筆筒大小啦，將大嘅筆筒叫做筆海，即係可能係25cm左右咁大個。啊，細嗰啲啊叫筆筒。咁關於筆筒最早出現嗰個年代咧，其實學術界佢意見不一嘅。咁呢兩幅咧。
So the third object is called the brush pot, and it's it was actually a brush holder. So as we can see from the paintings, it looks like a shelf. So that's where pens or brushes are rested, it's a controversial, and it's being debated when this object was first introduced to the world.
但係故宮博物院專家咧，馮先明先生佢喺嗰個中國古陶瓷詞典入邊咧就話，筆筒始建於北宋，流行於明清。 啊，器型似筒狀，但係宋代嗰陣時個筆筒咧，可能口徑細啲啊，佢傳世唔多。
So there's this expert called Fong Xianming. In his book, he says the brush pot or brush holder first appeared in Song Dynasty and later popularized in Ming and Qing Dynasty. It looks like a little container. Yet during the Song Dynasty, all these brush holders were having a small opening. So we don't have many of these left nowadays.
咁宋之前咧，嗰啲人通常都係用木竹啊玉啊嗰啲材質嚟到去製作，佢瓷質就不同，就係唔多啊。因為宋之前個瓷器咧，去到明清嗰陣時比較流行啲啊嚇，去到明清嗰陣時咧，佢已經出現咗青花啊、五彩啊呢啲樣式嘅瓷製不同啦。咁佢嘅優點咧，就係可以用鮮豔明快嗰種彩繪。 以人物畫嘅風格去表達呢個故事啊，咁有時上面咧仲要畫啲山水畫啊，或者人物啊題詩啊，去將嗰個筆筒更加符合呢個文人嘅品味啊，所以佢係一個文人書案嘅常設之物。So
during Song Dynasty, most of the brush pots were made of copper, wood, and bamboo, and it's very rare to see porcelain brush pot. So during Ming and Qing Dynasty, we see many brush pots were made in different styles, including blue and white porcelain. And actually, usually we do lots of paintings on the surface of this porcelain brush pot. So to match with the taste of the scholars, so this is a must item on the desk of scholars.
看到一個是晚明的古畫，一個是清代的。
So these paintings are made in Qing Dynasty, and we see the brush pot on the painting.
咁頭先咧，我哋睇咗兩件單色釉嘅瓷器啦。咁跟住落嚟咧，我哋可以睇下依個色彩豐富依個人物不同咯。即係會睇到一個老翁咧，佢戴住依個豆笠，拎住個漁網。
着住寬褲喺睇呢個祠堂咧，可以笑容滿面。佢形成咗一個好温馨嘅一種瑜伽樂嘅一個場景，好充滿呢個生活氣息。所以佢呢個畫畫嘅風格咧，佢灑脱自然，不拘一格咁樣就等一畫。佢嘅描描幾筆咧，佢就有好強嘅立體感，同埋佢個樣啊，佢個神態捕捉咧係非常之呢個。 即係好人神兼備應該講係嘛啊咁所以咧佢就可以睇得出呢個粉彩呢個工藝嘅特色咧，同埋佢嗰個瓷畫啊，佢一個好深厚嘅功底啊有啊。
As now we see a rather colourful object, we call it a Famille-Rose brush pot. So you see the picture where this fisherman. He's a very lively facial expression. The style of painting is very free, and it's very vivid. It shows the folk life back in the days.
咁呢個故事題材啊，瑜伽樂咧啊，即係佢描繪呢個漁夫啊，佢好歡樂嘅嗰種勞動場景啊。佢有時瑜伽樂咧，佢有好多個畫面題材嘅喎，佢有啲係。 飲酒慶祝豐收啊！佢有啲係漁翁得利啊，咁樣佢就將嗰種人民勞動嗰種場景啊、生活嘅狀況咧，佢同嗰個自然景色咧就融合埋一齊。咁咧，佢依一種嘅圖案咧喺康熙雍正嗰陣時咧就有出現㗎啦。佢嘅風格好明快，咁其實你可以睇到人哋嗰陣時嗰個安居樂業啊，佢對美好生活嗰種追求啊。
So usually the artwork on this brush pots is about the fishermen, so sometimes it depicts the celebration of the harvest, sometimes about other scenarios. So it's a very good combination between life and nature. And during Qing Dynasty, especially the Emperor Yongzheng and Kangxi, so these type of artwork were very popular. It shows a lively style and also their pursuit of happiness and good life.
你可以睇到點解呢個粉彩呢個人物不同，佢色彩嘅咁豐富咧？你可以睇下，佢總共用咗五種顏色啊，即係綠色、藍色、紅色、黃色同埋黑色。佢五種粉彩，佢話佢一般用藍色嘅粉彩係比較少見嘅。咁佢釉上面繪畫啦，依一種係一種中低温嘅釉彩啊。 佢係初創呢個粉彩初創於康熙晚期，康熙時期。佢嗰陣時係佢個清宮造辦署啊，佢燒製呢個珐琅彩瓷成功之後咧，佢係為咗降低呢個燒製温度啊，同埋成功率咧，佢係創燒出嚟一種釉上彩嘅瓷器。佢喺顏色配比嗰陣時咧，佢係借鑑咗珐琅彩好多嘅一個色彩配比嘅技法。
So as you can see, this painting, it's used five different colors, the green, the blue, the red, the yellow, and black as well. So it's very rare to see, and it's actually a particular low temperature glaze technology. And it, as we see, the gouache was actually first invented during the Kangxi period. And so this is an innovation. In terms of the color use and the way of firing porcelain.
係啊，我想補充下咧，佢頭先話珐琅彩咧，佢係創燒喺康熙啊嘛，因為佢珐琅彩佢需要燒出嚟嘅温度太高啊，喺個瓷嗰度咧畫珐琅咧，佢個瓷胎好容易承受唔住會炸裂嘅，因為我哋成日見到咧珐琅彩喺銅胎嗰度啊嘛，銅胎珐琅咁喺瓷胎嗰度好難嘅，所以佢為咗降低個温度咧。
So as I was saying just now, it's so-called the Famille-Rose. It was actually first invented in Qing Dynasty, and usually we see it in copperware, so, but now in porcelain ware, it actually requires a rather higher temperature in terms of to make it completed. So.
咁到咗呢個雍正朝咧，佢粉彩就進入呢個盛期啦。因為咧，佢雍正粉彩咧喺康熙嗰度咧，佢已經有咗好大個發展啦。佢無論造型啊、彩繪定係紋飾，都達到一個好空前嘅一個高度。咁其中一個好重要原因咧，就係我哋國內嘅古玩藝術界都公認噶啦，就係因為佢雍正嗰個審美係清朝所有皇帝入邊最好嘅。 因為佢本人咧，佢就好本身就好中意瓷器啊。清宮實錄有記載咧，佢雍正咧，佢經常會對住呢個宮廷入邊嘅瓷器咧，佢加以評價。佢會親自過問啊，同埋佢會派啲官員咧去呢個管理呢個瓷業嘅生產啊。佢俾佢自己意見咯。所以佢因為佢有呢個追求啊，所以佢嗰陣時咧，佢瓷器水準係非常高嘅。佢係堪稱呢個粉彩瓷器嘅代表作啊。
So we talk about Famille-Rose porcelain. So it was actually reached its peak during the Emperor Yongzheng, who was considered one of the best emperors who has the best and highest standard of aesthetics. So he himself loved porcelain so much. And so sometimes he would actually went to the factories to overlook and supervise the workers to make porcelains.
另外咧，佢由於呢個粉彩嘅色彩好柔和啦，佢又畫得好精細，佢本身都好受我哋中國人歡迎嘅。佢獨到之處就係喺呢個彩繪嗰陣時啊，佢加一種白色嘅顏料叫做玻璃白。咁玻璃白咧，佢有一個乳濁嘅效果嘅，即係牛奶咁。佢咧佢就加咗之後咧。 你依個大紅大紫咧，就變咗做粉大紅大綠，就變咗粉紅粉綠啦。啊，同埋咧，佢可以發揮到個渲染嘅技法，即係譬如話，你一滴玻璃白入邊加一滴綠色 ，OK， 咁你用毛筆咁樣慢慢掃，慢慢掃。佢就係一個呢邊深嗰邊淺嘅效果，依個渲染，嗰種渲染嘅效果個層次感啊，佢個色彩咧就一下子就豐富起身嚟。
So as you can see, the Famille-Rose porcelain, the color is very soft and gentle. And the uniqueness of this is that when it was made, they would put a pigment called glassy white. So this is actually creates an effect of the milky texture. So it also creates a gradient effect when it comes to drawing and painting. So it creates certain pastel colors as well. So you can see the layers as a result created on the porcelain.
跟住落嚟，我哋講到最尾一件，我哋屏風啦，都係我哋中國傳統家具入邊生產最早歷史最悠久，同埋佢個等級地位好高嘅一個大型器具。因為佢屏風咧，佢體量好大嘅，所以咧佢有好高嘅一個裝飾同埋藝術審美價值咯。即係我唔知大家有冇睇過一啲出土嗰啲古畫或者相咧，個戰國嗰陣時就有啊，好大嘅屏風大嗰個skin啦，啲人就坐喺前面咁樣，所以咁。
So the last object we will talk about today is screen. So the traditional Chinese screen is actually one of the earliest traditional furnitures that China produced. So it's usually a very huge, usually it's very decorative and has a high aesthetics. So I'm not sure whether you watched some of the TVs before. So some screens that you see during the warring kingdom period, so they are very big as the screen. So usually people just sit in front of the screen and talk.
咁啊，南宋嘅學者咧，趙熙學咧，就喺佢本書《洞天清錄集》入邊咧，就稱顯平。佢嗰個顯平嘅起源咧，係由於呢個北宋嘅大文學家蘇適同埋個大詞作家王庭堅嘅。佢係寫《古墓燕平》，畫燕冥，啊。 自東坡山谷始作燕平，啊，即係話係呢個燕平呢個種類咧，係蘇東坡同王庭堅發明。So
now we are talking. Now we look at the object called inkstone screen. So this is actually a new invention, according to one of the scholars. Writes that this. Inkstone screen was actually first invented and popularized from Su Dongbo as well as and Shan Gu, the other scholar during Song Dynasty. Sorry.
咁燕平咧，佢作為一個好優雅工具咧，喺宋代嗰陣時，其實佢已經有好多文人推崇啦。佢喺屏風嘅大小咧，佢作出咗改變啦。佢係一個好絕佳嘅一個裝飾品。 佢除咗體積細咗之外咧，佢嘅結構同大屏風一模一樣嘅喎。啊，呢種桌上屏嘅作用咧，都係主要攞嚟擋風同埋一個遮蔽。因為咧，你有時咧佢寫字嗰陣時啊，你唔想俾人哋一眼就望到你寫咩咧，佢就個燕屏喺度擋一擋啦。咁同埋咧，佢個燕台喺隔離咧，佢就防止啲風咧吹乾啲墨畫。
So as we can see now, the small screen, a small inkstone screen, actually has the same structure as those big screen or normal screen. Yet it's actually a very small object. It's perfect for decoration, and it is used to block the wind. Actually, and sometimes when you write, the ink might get dried easily. So it's one of the purposes is to block the wind, but also it's the purpose is to keep privacy of the person who's writing, because sometimes you don't want other people to see what you're writing.
咁燕平咧，佢發展到去清朝咧，佢造型材質已經發生咗好大改變啦。佢同埋咧，佢由一開始我哋輔助我哋書寫一個文房器具咧，佢逐漸演變成一個文人士大夫嘅一個案頭嘅稱喚啦，佢一個變咗一個清上之氣啊。So
we see the development of inkstone screen has witnessed lots of changes until Qing Dynasty. At the beginning, inkstone screen was used as a complementary tools in the scholar's studios. But now, in Qing Dynasty, it is used as a decoration, and people like to appreciate the beauty of inkstone screen as an art object.
咁去到清末嗰陣時啦，佢發展得仲好添。佢一個，因為一個清末嗰陣時，佢文人畫師啊，佢依個淺鋼彩咧，開創咗依個文人詞畫嘅先河啊。咁所以現評嘅製作咧，都進入到依個繁花似錦依個新嘅時代啦。好似掛瓶啊、桌上瓶呢啲文房用品咧，佢融入咗依個詞畫嘅意趣，佢立意好高遠。 所以咧，佢嗰啲人咧，佢對瓷器嗰種審美理念啊，佢由中意皇家嗰種官僚咧，佢逐漸轉變為一個中意呢種彰顯個性啊，呢種抒情寫意啊，就轉向呢種由中國國畫衍生出嚟嘅文人詞畫啦。
So towards the late Qing Dynasty, it's actually the beginning of scholarly porcelain painting era, where actually even on this inkstone screens we see this porcelain paintings. And in the past, people actually pursued that type of aristocratic aesthetics of porcelain. But now these scholars and gentlemen, they and literati, they all pursue this personal and also very personalized, very stylized kind of aesthetics where they can express themselves through these art objects.
咁去到呢、這個點解佢文人詞畫會咁受歡迎呢？因為其實喺詞畫上面咧，題寫作者嘅名啊、題詩啊、啊處款啊。 呢啲咧其實係中國瓷器史上嘅一種創舉嚟嘅，因為佢第一次咧令到我哋中國畫由宋元時期以嚟形成嘅一種詩書畫三位一體結合嘅呢種優良文化咧，佢表現咗喺瓷器上面啦，所以令到呢個瓷器畫啊同埋呢個中國畫結合叫做咩？中國畫入中國瓷啊，所以佢文化氣息更加濃郁。
So in the early Qing Dynasty, we see this new technique for baking this porcelain. We call it scholar porcelain painting, which is actually an innovation because in the past, we see that the traditional Chinese arts are three in one. For example, the poetry, calligraphy, and painting, they are all usually combined together. And now we can see that combination on the porcelain objects. So this is an innovation.
咁喺清朝滅亡之後咧，佢依個官窯嘅生產體系咧，佢都隨之解體啦。咁嗰種多工聚合作啊、匠氣型啊、嗰種景德鎮嘅瓷器生產體系咧，就轉變啦，就解體咗。所以有大量嘅文人畫家咧，佢就聚集就喺景德鎮咧，佢就為咗呢個衝破呢個瓷器嘅傳統造型同文飾嘅束縛。 咁所以喺當時咧，佢其實湧現咗一批有各自個人風格嘅名家啦，好似珠三八友咁。其實其中呢個黃石良大師咧，都係其中之一。咁呢個黃石良大師咧，佢生於呢個1922年嘅，佢12歲就絕學咧，佢跟隨住佢景德鎮嘅叔父黃大凡。個黃大凡喺 右下角，佢係珠三八友嚟嘅，所以佢跟住佢叔父珠三八友去學習詞畫。So
after the end of Qing Dynasty, all this official kiln sites and its related systems were disintegrated. So there are many craftsmen, and they went to Jingde town, as I mentioned before. So they would like to innovate and create their own porcelain and techniques. So one of them is actually Wang Xi Liang, who was actually born in 1922, and he was one of the famous ceramic artists called one of the eight friends of Zhu Shan.
Mm. And, yeah. 佢就好擅長畫山水啊、人物咯，佢就先後創作咗一啲藝術作品，好似革命搖籃井岡山啊，佢就被收錄咗喺呢個北京人民大會堂西廳咯，啊咁樣，咁 接下來我們就看看黃石堂大師創作的這款粉彩琴棋書畫作成品，其實它的瓷質是非常雪白的，它一共四幅，由左至右分別描繪琴棋書畫，它是古代四大文化藝術琴棋書畫，它一件一套四件，它 其實燒製嗰陣時嘅最難咧，佢就係唔可以出現偏差，因為佢四套必須要同時成功，佢唔可以出現有一幅係有偏差。咁上面咧，佢每一幅咧，佢嘅小瓷畫上面咧都有題字嘅喎，佢上面咧有上書，壬午年3月，黃石梁寫於珠山。 咁由此可以推斷呢啲幅瓷畫其實佢1942年，因為壬午年咧佢查到嘅1942年佢所作係黃石梁大師嘅早期作品啦。因為佢二年生啊嘛，二年生四二年都係20歲啫，佢12年絕學，12歲絕學去學瓷畫。咁係佢嘅跟佢叔父學之後嘅早期作品。咁其實都係。 即係佢跟咗叔父之後，佢慢慢展現佢呢個瓷畫上嘅天賦啦，佢同埋民國嗰陣時咧生活好艱難噶嘛，咁所以咧佢學得好認真，所以佢就達到呢個日後嘅聲名大噪啊呢個成就咯。So
as we see, Wang Xi Liang has actually a very long artistic career in porcelain painting for 50 years. So he has painted many important artworks, and one of them is actually collected in the Great Hall in Beijing. And now we see on screen is actually a piece, an art piece called Qing Qi Shu Hua, which is actually the four traditional Chinese arts, Guqing, Chinese chess, calligraphy, and painting. So the quality of this porcelain is very, very good. And we see the hardest part is to keep the to maintain the consistency of the quality of this porcelain, because you cannot make any mistakes from any one of them. So they have to be consistent. And as we can see, he also signed on these porcelain paintings, written 1942. So he was born in 1922, as I mentioned just now. So he started learning porcelain painting since the age of 12. So he was actually finishing, he finished these set of artworks by the age of 20. So it is actually one of his earlier works. And so we can see he was terribly talented and in creating such an excellent art piece.
順便提一句,黃石梁大師他現在還在生,他已經90幾歲了。
So he is still alive now. He's in his 90s now.
咁即係佢點解人哋中意呢個琴棋書畫咧？佢係因為琴入邊咧，佢有情韻，佢棋入邊咧有天地。佢以前啊，古人係對弈噶嘛。我哋睇到頭先好多古畫咧，對弈噶嘛。佢以前嗰啲生活方式活動啊，冇乜娛樂噶。 就彈琴、對弈咁，書中有乾坤，畫中有詩意。咁呢四大元素入邊咧，佢演繹咗呢個中國傳統文化嘅韻味咯，咁其實睇到黃石梁筆下嘅人物咧，佢都係比較素雅嘅，佢好淡淡，佢又冇一個濃妝抹影啊，佢冇一個濃妝抹影啊，佢就顯得一副呢個小家碧玉咁樣咯，就。 即係好有氣韻，佢連圖畫上面咧，嗰啲花啊，嗰啲竹葉啊，都栩栩如生啊，可以睇。其實你可以睇啊，依種呢個侍女嗰啲衣摺咧，呢種色彩過度變化就我頭先提到嗰種圈染啊，咁其實係好難嘅，因為點解咧？喺傳統嘅粉彩瓷畫入邊咧。 因為佢粉彩瓷係礦物質嚟㗎嘛，佢要填要一定厚度嘅。咁佢完咗之後咧，佢要有一個雪白嘅料水，佢全部覆蓋啊。你燒爐之前咧係睇唔出佢嘅色彩效果，佢一模一樣色㗎。你完全睇唔出佢嗰個色彩嘅過渡啊！燒之前。 咁你畫嗰陣時咧，你就自己你知道邊度多咗，邊度少咗，你要自己知啊！你燒之前你唔知嘅，即係燒完之後你又可以估嘅咁。咁咧，佢就要經過800度左右嘅温度咧燒之後咧啊，佢就所以咧，佢要有一個非常成熟的一個技巧和經驗，才可以在腦海裏面預知到它燒出來的那種色彩效果。所以為什麼人們說陶瓷藝術是土和火的一個藝術呢？就是上面有一個這樣的因素。所以為什麼是粉彩呢？這個作畫這麼千變萬化，這麼受人喜歡呢，都是這個原因。
Now So we see the topic of Qingqi Shuhua, the four Chinese great arts. They actually captures the essence of Chinese beauty and the Chinese life, as like chess and also painting and playing musical instruments. It's all about emotional exchange between two persons. And as you can see just now, the paintings, we see these girls or the figures, they are not overdressed or over adorned, and they're rather plain, but also you see on the costumes there, you see the gradient changes of colors. So this is very challenging, because when it comes to firing all these clay bodies and making porcelains, you never know how the clay would turn out to be. You'll only rely on experience and also the very mature techniques, so that we can make a beautiful porcelain object. So people call the porcelain art is actually an art of combined with fire and clay, so that it's the charm of porcelain.
咁跟住落嚟咧，我哋歡樂嘅時間過得特別快啊！就係我哋嘅提問環節啦。
Now we have a Q&A session. Now this is the end of my presentation. So you're more than welcome to ask any questions.
係啊，大家對呢個文房啊或者文房瓷器有冇啲咩想問啊
？Anything you want to know more about the concept of scholar
studio？ 睇大家有咩所需要嗰個瞭解啊嚇，嗰瓷器嗰啲文房嘅各方面嗰啲製作過程啊嚇，我可以發表。
Floor is now open. Thank you. You want to know more about？
你翻譯啊？
Thank you for your comprehensive explanation for the Office of the Literati. I have two questions. The first is, most of the inkstones are black or dark gray. Is it a special stone? And if we had just plain water to it, it comes out the ink? Or is just a container and we need to put the ink inside? Because I wonder, because of the color of the stone, if we had water, if it dissolves the stone and it becomes black. So this is the first question.
佢有第一個問題就係好多謝你嘅詳細嘅講解啦。咁佢其中一個第一個問題就係究竟嗰啲墨砚嘅砚台啊，其實通常都是黑色或者暗墨綠色的，如果我只是加清水下去，其實它會不會出到一些這些黑色或者墨綠色的顏色呢？即是還是有究竟那個加水的過程和那個墨染之間那個會不會產生其他顏色啊，或者是那個過程是怎樣？
這樣的，那個其實砚台就是用來用的，咁用咧通常咧以黑色為準為基礎，咁咧佢有黑色嘅墨，或者有啲用礦物質去磨提煉出嚟都會有啊，就唔係煙台就一定係要磨出嚟，或者溝水就係一定係黑色，呢個應該唔係一絕對嘅，係應該係磨煉嗰陣時有顏料嘅礦物質先有顏色。
哦。即係嗰個台，嗰個煙，
佢本身係要磨完之後咧，佢個煙台佢有墨粉噶嘛，佢墨粉佢溶喺嗰個水入邊，咪變咗墨色。
用墨係用墨嘅就墨色，
所以唔係嗰個台嘅色，而係嗰支嘢嘅色。
係啦，
So yeah, the gentleman was saying that for the ink stone, so it's usually black. Oh, it's either because of the materials that it's being made, the mineral or the material that's being made usually are black. That's why it's black. Or after a while, when it's being used with the ink stone, then it became black in color.
But long.
You understand, Joe? My English not so good.
有時咧，佢會
the color.
唔係有時咧，佢可以溝金粉，有時係溝朱砂。咁你寫出嚟嗰啲咧，金七字咧。
Yes, sometimes you can actually put the gold leaves or actually a cinnabar in, and so it actually depends on the material you put. So you can dip it and then paint and
draw. So the ink stone is just a container for the ink.
I think there are two things. One is, 所以佢話其實個鹽其實就係一個容器。
係啊，容器。
It's only a container. Probably it's called the ink well or ink stone, yes. So there are two things like ink stick and ink stone.
Mm-hmm.
我諗佢意思係話，究竟呢個鹽究竟會唔會出顏色、出墨水？定係個鹽其實就係裝水？唔會出，因為你而家用咩材料就出咩材料咯。係啊，即係其實係兩個器具啊嘛，一個係溝水嚟磨嘅，一個係墨墨條啊嘛。
墨期後期寫書法嘅，係寫書法用嘅。 如果畫畫咧，係啲礦物質嗰啲咧，就一定係礦物質石磨出嚟，顯出啲顏色。所以其實佢係一個台器。呢個就係墨。嗰個台作用。
So what he's holding is actually an ink stick. You use the ink stick to grind.
This for writing.
The ink.
If painting, so many color is different. Use the color is different. 呢個寫字就用黑色。
My second question is probably more difficult.
第二個問題仲難，佢話。Until
now, I find very difficult to differentiate between guanyao, geyao, and longchan with crackles. Because sometimes I see longchan with crackles and I cannot distinguish from guanyao. Or geyao. And I would like also to know a little bit more about the ice cracked glaze that was used in the Song Dynasty.
Joe, 開片係咪 ice crack？ You mean？
係啊，冰裂啊，冰裂係啦，冰裂嘅究竟係兩個係點樣出嚟一個冰裂
？How does it make or ice crack？
Ice crack in English, I don't know.
But what about ice crack？
Imagine when you have a lake.
Yeah. But what do you want to?
If it is cracked, this is the appearance of the glaze of the so-called ice cracked glaze.
Yeah. That what's your question in terms of ice crack?
You mean? How to differentiate between longchen with cracks?
Longchen.
Guanyao.
Longchen. Longchen.
Longchen. 即係嗰個冰裂究竟係點樣分辨啊？即係龍泉同埋官窑同埋唔同嘅冰裂。Guanyao,
you see sometimes so many cracking.
你講廣東話啦，講廣東話。
官窑咧，嗰啲爆裂咧就可能比較係大長紋啲，歌謠咧就雜亂無章啲，就細啲，但係冇百分百 100% OK， 好啦。嗰個至於話官窑歌謠有時候有啲紋理係好接近嘅，啊，但係如果你哋唔介意嘅，加入我嘅群組就可以發啲個案俾你哋睇。 佢係有嗰個官歌不分嗰種嚇，
古時候就有官歌不分
嗰種説法嘅。
Okay, so usually Usually guanyao, the cracking is actually in a longer patterns, long line pattern, while the geyao, the cracking is usually quite messy or chaotic. It's a, like it's a very it's sporadic, but in the past some of them said that some it's hard to distinguish them. In certain occasions, they don't make any differences or distinguish.
Because歌謠佢有一個叫做金戈鐵線，係啊，佢所以咧佢有兩種，佢一種大嘅紋係金線。
So for geyao, you see there's the crisscrossing pattern sometimes. One is in the gold lines, the other one silver lines. So they crisscross for geyao. Sometimes we see that pattern there.
And longchun, no many cracking. Sometimes have some. Also maybe a little bit, look is a little bit long. Sometimes. 成個樽咧，成個咧好似一條長線咁樣，暖暖地嚇咁樣落嘅，就冇話好似歌謠嘅歌謠咧，拉只歌謠，要先嚇。歌謠
is that crisscrossing pattern.
Almost 咁大格啲咁啊嚇，農村嚇。同埋佢有清。阿周係啊，周啊，周啊，周時，long time span。因為歌謠係一個好大嘅課題，佢點解咧？佢有分浙江嘅歌謠。 佢有分後期景德鎮嘅歌謠，佢有清後期仿嘅。佢所以咧，佢去到後期咧，佢其實去到清嗰陣時咧，佢兩種技術已經混合。你如果講歌謠嘅話，只能夠去講宋嘅歌謠。So
it's a very big topic where we talk about 歌謠 because there are many different 歌謠, some from Zhejiang province, some from Jingde town, but there are also some imitations exist during Qing Dynasty. So where the techniques were combined. So when we talk about geyao now, we are mostly talking about the geyao in Song Dynasty.
Zhou, this one look, guanyao. But this one is a Guangxi copy guanyao. You see sometimes the cracking, maybe sometimes see maybe yuyao, sometimes. But this is after. Sometimes cooking is different. Almost is look is 100% same as same. Maybe some similar. And then in the double chair.
You say Cantonese.
This is江水那时的官窑. So that's the guanyao during the Emperor Guangxi in of Qing Dynasty.
嗯，佢已經清代嗰陣時，佢已經好多改良過。So
there are lots of renovated techniques in Qing Dynasty. So it's pretty like not the same as that of Song Dynasty.
嗯，仲有冇其他？Thank
you.
唔係解唔解答到佢個疑問
？Did they answer your question? He's asking.
obviously, it is difficult because I read a lot of articles about this subject, and there is no consensus about it.
It's a big topic.
Tomorrow afternoon, we will have tea.
The best way is to see a sample of each.
A real prototype, a real typical
one of each.
最好方法就係即係睇下真嘅去分辨。
When there's a several sample in your eyes, you can tell.
仲有冇其他人提出問題？大家一齊交流下，冇所謂。
喂，hello， 你好。咁啱啱啊，馮生即係介紹咗宋代係一個比較美好嘅年代啦，即係誒詩啊、畫啊，或者啲用品都比較精緻精美。咁我想知道係因為宋代突然間有一啲技術嘅突破，令到佢製作呢啲用品嘅時候更加靚啊，定係因為可能個文化導致更加多嘅一啲用品或者詩畫推出即係喺宋代嗰度有呢樣嘢咧？
呢個第一個問題。OK，
So you're saying that in Song Dynasty, it's an era of beauty, like lots of poets and paintings and all that. But what are the reasons of this prosperity happening in Song Dynasty? Was it because a breakthrough in technology or because of a certain culture that was created and contribute to this prosperity in Song Dynasty?
其實這個是一個大問題，因為為什麼好像突然間看到宋代有這麼多出來，其實時間是一個延續的，它旁後面去到五代的時候其實一直都有，但是為什麼那時候不多呢？因為那時候是五胡亂華，五胡亂華它是北方的時候，它已經是佔領了中原了，那時候其實它是 相對於我哋漢代嘅文化咧，佢更加注重佢嗰個胡人嘅文化。咁去到漢代點解咁多咧？因為漢代嗰陣時佢係必須要復辟，佢漢代第一個諗法必須要復辟我哋漢人嘅文化。佢係國家機構第一個朝代係由上到下去仿呢個研究呢個青銅器嘅，佢要揾翻我哋根源，我哋嘅文化根源。 所以佢會有呢個古文運動出現，佢係崇古，係宋代差唔多應該係最崇尚古代嘅一個朝代，因為佢經過五胡亂華，所以佢有呢個邏輯出現，所以咧佢呢個成個嘅邏輯線就係咁樣咯。
Thank you for your question. It's a big question as well. One of the reasons why that prosperity happened in Song Dynasty, we need to look at the Tang Dynasty. Actually, right after Tang Dynasty, there was this period called 16 Kingdoms and Five Barbarians Kingdom period, where China was actually being invaded by the tribes from the north. And that was the moment when the country was being conquered by these barbarians, so-called barbarians from the north. And so Qing Dynasty was actually the moment when everyone wanted to trace and retrace the beauty and the prosperity in the Han Dynasty or more ancient times. So that is the reason why there's so many breakthrough or that's this trend of beautiful artworks existing in Song Dynasty.
咁唔該曬先。咁第二條問題咧就係啱啱就介紹咗好多隻宋朝嘅藏品啦。咁我想了解翻就係會唔會有某一啲藏品係特別具有呢個收藏價值？ 因為喺北宋呢個年間或者宋朝呢個年間係特別係重要嘅，咁導致我哋依家收藏嘅話係個價值比較高咁樣。So
is there any valuable objects that you recommend people to collect during the Song Dynasty? Yes, that's it. That's the question. For higher value.
咁宋代嘅瓷咧係值得收藏嘅，所以佢咧係有五大名窯出現咗啊，先即係後人咧先啊將個五大名窯咧一路一路咁樣啊傳落去。咁啊首先咧咁係汝窯啦，汝窯係最為灰嘅最少嘅即係比較北宋嗰陣時咧係量數量唔多啊。 好啦，跟住咧，觀光、定坤呢幾樣咧都係值得收藏嘅宋朝文人嗰個文化雅致到咧加上嗰陣時宋朝係成熟咗就陶瓷啊所以產生咗有五大名窯出嚟啦。So
I think the porcelain in Song Dynasty has a very high value for collection. So as we know that there was this five famous kiln sites during the Song Dynasty. Of course, Yu Yao, one of the it's precious because it's very rare. And then of course, Guan Yu, Guo Yu, Deng Yu, Quan Yu, right? So So during Song Dynasty, the technique of producing porcelain was already very matured. So I believe that it's very porcelain. It's an art object that you should collect.
我補充少少啊，其實我覺得咧，你想知道收藏啲咩咧，你睇翻佢古時候嗰啲古畫就知啦。即係點解咧？因為佢古畫係記錄佢士大夫嘅生活啊嘛。咁當時嗰啲人喺嗰個階層，佢都用緊嗰啲嘢，即係佢自己都中意嗰啲嘢。咁證明係嗰陣時都係算係好頂級噶啦，係咪先？咁你按翻佢哋嘅收藏，咁實冇死啊！
So I want to add on something is that if you don't want to know what to collect and just look at those paintings during that period, because these paintings usually recorded the lives back then of these scholars and literati. So they always depict what they collect and what they use in everyday life. So that is actually a guarantee of the value of collection if you just look at and follow what the paintings depict.
有冇問題？有。
Sorry, just because I suddenly remind that you didn't mention Yao Zhou, you didn't mention Ru Yao, and didn't mention, I think, Ding Yao, and they are all also very exquisite, with very beautiful pieces.
搖州搖定搖嗰啲你都冇講，因為話係好頂級、好靚嘅。係啊係啊。係啦，嗯。 原則上係五大名窯居先，跟住咧，瑤州啊、粵窯啊、瑤州、瑜州、瑜州嚇嗰啲咧，依家啊吉州窯、吉州窯、建窯啊，依家係其實咧係圍繞住五大名窯啊，五大名窯 ，OK，
the five famous
其實十幾個窯口名窯。 係圍繞住五大名窯，嗰個價值觀念咧係比較會攀升嘅。啊
，so the kiln signs that surrounded the five famous kiln signs are that's what we are talking about just now. Of course, we prioritize the five famous kiln sites.
啊，I want to show them back.其實窯口好，你講中國哦，就算啦。一般係收藏咧，一般係分明清瓷、中古瓷就宋瓷、原始瓷。一般咧就最依家最興盛咧就係宋代宋瓷同埋明清瓷。其實 佢好多唔同嘅窯口咧，佢都有好靚嘅一個嘢。So
many
係啊，好似瑤州窯咧，佢依家北京普利拍賣咧，佢去到嗰個最高成交價都去到2600萬，加埋佣金應該唔止啊。佢依家咧，佢慢慢啲人就發現翻佢以前嗰啲價值咯。
阿周，五大名窯。 比較貴，其他嗰啲十幾個名窯咧，都係會跟住啲價錢係上嘅，所以咧，如果五大名窯唔上，其他嘅價錢咧就肯定係冇咁快上嘅，譬如龍泉啊、粵窯啊、瑤州窯啊、吉州窯啊、建窯啊，嗰啲係一齊上，佢哋係上嘅附帶性嘅。Okay.
So mostly the porcelains from the other kiln sites surrounding the five famous kiln sites were actually the values of them will be increased because of the value being boosted of those five famous kiln sites. So, for example, even for Yuzhou Yu, it was lately in auctioned in the auction house Puli in Beijing for 26 million renminbi before the commission. It's calculated. So it's so the so nowadays people are rediscovering the value of these dozens of porcelains from dozens of these kiln sites surrounding the five famous kiln sites.
Mm. Yeah, 2 million and 2 billion. Okay, have 2 billion, have 2 million. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
今晚個活動。
咁就多謝大家出席啊！我哋再次以後未來咧，希望仲有多啲其他嘅。我仲有一個少少嘅問題想要問下大家，因為我哋個文房雅趣咧呢個講座咧已經講咗第三期啦，係嘛？咁呢個應該係最尾一期啊！咁我想問下大家跟住落嚟。 感興趣邊啲課題咧，或者想聽啲乜嘢咧，就想做個少少嘅調查啊，咁啊想。
A question for all of you, since this is the third edition of the series, the literati series. So what are the topics you are interested in the future, and you can share with us?
咁或者遲啲啊，我哋喺個Good嗰度啦嚇啊。 多啲去了解啲人嚇，先再制定下一堂嘅嚇嗰個題目啊，好嘛？Maybe
we can discuss in the future.
Okay. 好啊！唔講啦，既然你講得擺低嘅都。OK，我哋可以大家可以加係啊，大家可以啊，如果有興趣加我哋個。
微信群啊，交流群，大家可以把咗阿鐘，或者之後咧，如果大家再有啲咩問題咧，歡迎嚟到我哋鋪頭嗰度傾偈啦。我哋有兩個鋪頭，一個係大三巴嘅中學跟，一個係M2M。歡迎有啲咩問題，即係唔好意思，可以繼續問我哋。係，哇，多謝你，你唔怕嫌悶就得啦。<笑>
嚟緊聽下啲木製傢俬啊！
你想聽下木製傢俬係嘛？係啊。OK OK OK OK。